हेलो फ्रेंड्स, केजी क्लासेस में आपका स्वागत है। आज हम आपको लाइफ ऑफ आर डब्ल्यू इमर्सन 1803 टू 1882। राल्फ वाल्डो इमर्सन वाज बोर्न इन बोस्टन मैसाचुसेट्स इन 1803। हिज एंसेस्टर हैड बीन इन अमेरिका फॉर 7 जनरेशंस डेटिंग बैक टू वन ऑफ द अर्ली इमिग्रेंट From old to New England, he descended of a long line of clergymen. His father was pastor of the first church. The family was always poor, sometimes passing through great poverty. Emerson's father died when he was only 88 years of age. The widowed mother was left with the responsibility of bringing up 5 sons, including Emerson. However, his mother and aunt managed to see that the children had proper education. With this aim in view, the family moved to Concord in 1814. There the children were set on to their education to Concord in 1814. There the children were set on to their education directed towards the vocation that characterized their ancestry. Emerson was sent to Boston Latin School and then to Harvard College. From there he graduated in 1817. Thereafter he planned to join the Divinity School, but poverty stood in his way. In order to overcome this difficulty, he taught for some time at a girls' school established by his brother William. He entered the Divinity School in 1825 and was licensed for the ministry in 1826. However, ill health sent him southward to recuperate family circumstances and the state of his health as well as financial necessities further delayed his career. In 1829 he became the associate pastor to Henry Weir in the Second Church of Boston. In 1832, however, after only 3 years, he resigned from the position because he could not in good conscience conduct religious rituals to which he himself felt uncomfortable. Emerson had married in 1829, but his wife died in 1831. Following this personal loss and his resignation from the pastorate, Emerson traveled to Europe and stayed there for almost a year. There he was seeking perspective on himself and his future. While in England, he met Coleridge, Wordsworth, and most important, Carlyle, who became his lifelong friend and correspondent. On his return from Europe, Emerson came back to the town of Concord. He began the public lecturing and writing while there to constitute his life work. With the exception of extensive lecture tour in the United States and 2 more trips to Europe, Emerson spent the rest of his long life in Concord. He married again in 1835 and his second wife bore him 4 children. The lecturers were the principal means of support of the Emerson's simple life. He gave about 1500 lectures in all. Slowing during all the years of his youth, Emerson had been carrying forward within himself a questioning search for the certitudes with which man might establish a direct institutional and infinite relation with the process of life itself. He had a firm belief in the potential ability of the individual to transcend church form by appearing and peeling the symbolic veil of nature in order to merge with the oversoul and domesticate its loss in his own character and life. He published Nature in 1836. The argument in this little book represented the result of his inner questioning, particularly since his voyage to Europe. It was the strongest motivating statement of American transcendentalism and romance as the most instructive brief expression of high romantic and American expectation. In order to supplement the income left him from the estate of Elian Tucker, Emerson became a frequent speaker in the Lyceum after the American Scholar and the Divinity School address of 1838. He became one of the most famous and sought after speakers in the nation with the publication of Essays. First series in 1841 and Essays, second series in 1844. His position as the leading figure of the newness was consolidated. He remains to this day a direct force in the school of American thought, opposed to a materialism that is divorced from the usage of life and from the necessities of healthy human personality. From 1842 to 1844, he edited the Dial, the official voice for the transcendentalist, including Emerson himself. Theodore Parker and Margaret Fuller. In 1847, he published poems and returned to Europe, where he delivered the lectures that were later published as Representative Man 1850, and where he absorbed the materials that were to become English Tracts 1856. Beginning in 1850 with the renunciation of Webster's stand on the fugitive slave law, Emerson lost some of his belief in the possibility of total freedom for the individual and became increasingly concerned with history and politics, although the latter Emerson found that he painfully had to make place for historical experience in his epistemology. He remained true to his idealistic belief in the infinite role of man. Experience is one result of Emerson's wrestling with the problem of man's ultimate being and his historical limitations. By the 1860s, Emerson began to accept his diminished power, the onslaught of age and increasing weakness had become noticeable before 1872, when he made an unsuccessful journey of recuperation to Europe. He lived on the Concord as the respected and revered visual symbol of his thought until his death in 1882. In his vigorous life, he had traveled widely throughout the country, propagating through countless lectures the energy of his ideas, which in theories of poetry, history, science, being and knowing unified into an organic purpose. The spiritual meaning of America, he came to be revered as a sage of Concord and optimistic mystic who denied the existence of evil. He is held as a thinker whose restorative message of liberation will speak to the human condition as long as there exists the human mind whose primacy he championed. Heading is the works of Emerson. Emerson's long life was one of literary, philosophical and mystical flowing. The 10 years after his return from Europe from 1832 to 1844 were the time when he formulated his basic ideas and wrote many of his essays for which he is famous today. At the beginning of his career, Emerson was a figure of controversy because of his opposition to authority in all spheres, yet he soon established a reputation as a sound and original thinker, orator and author. Eventually, he became known on account of his writing and lectures throughout the country at the Siege of Concord. His major works can be classified as follows. The Journals. Emerson wrote or edited several journals from 1820 to 1876. They contain Emerson's first significant writing. They constitute a full record of Emerson's development and afford an intimate view of his mind. He formed the habit of keeping a journal while at college and continued it systematically for over 50 years. Like Thoreau, Hawthorne and other 19th century writers, he would jot down in a notebook or journal ideas that occurred to him, original verse, passes from his reading, etc. He called his journal his saving bank. From them he drew material for his lectures, essay and poems, though often his essays were distilled version of his lectures. The journals make it clear that though he dwelt constantly with profound ideas and though he was a lover of truth, Emerson was not a philosopher in the sense of one who attempted to establish a systematic body of thought. The journals are significantly revealing and helping to illuminate the essays and poems. They also reveal the direction towards which his mind and reading habits were developing. In 1842, he wrote in his journal the following exhortation to himself: "Thou shalt read Homer, Aeschylus, Sophocles, Euripides, Aristophanes, Plato, Chaucer, Dante, Rabelais, Montaigne, Shakespeare, Bacon, Milton, Goethe." He also studied the English Romantics and the author of the Hindu scriptures and the Bible. This passage gives us an idea as to what self-reliance meant to Emerson. His intellectual dedication was one of his moral imperatives, all the more demanding because he had cut himself free from external direction. As a scholar, he never ceased seeking, which included a vast amount of ecclesiastic reading. The books he cherished, he made his own. Indeed, he used them to help him affirm the supreme importance of intellectual independence. Nature. This was Emerson's first published book, which appeared in 1836, a year or so after Carlyle's Sartor Resartus. It expresses his fundamental concept of transcendentalism and anticipates such latter works as the oversoul immersion rites in it. In the woods, I became a transparent eyeball. I see all the currents of universal being circulate through me. I am part and parcel of God. The American Scholar. This was published in 1837. This and the Divinity School Address 1838 taken together made immersion famous over the country. These two created a great controversy and a sharp reaction from the church authorities. Therein he expressed his disregard for authority and great concern for the individual. The Divinity School Address applied the idea of American Scholar to religion. Immersion openly rejects ecclesiastic dominion over the spiritual life of the individual and advocates that man should become his own church. He holds that truth is attainable only through intuition. It cannot be received second hand. Essay First Series. The first series of Emerson's essay was published in 1851. This series included Self-Reliance, The Oversoul, Compensation, Spiritual Loss, Love, Friendship and History. Essay Second Series. The second series of essays appeared in 1843. These two volumes contain the most important collection of Emerson's prose. In these volumes, he brought to fruition his unique form of the prose essay. As Spiller says, the new form which Emerson developed is neither wholly essay nor wholly lecture. Its unit is the carefully wrought sentence, each contained in crystalline suspension the whole meaning of essay. In the essay, the poet Emerson says that poet is the man who sees that which others dream of, traverses the whole scale of experience, and is representative of man in virtue of being the largest power of receive and to impart. This man of special vision, this artist isolated by truth and by his art, must nonetheless be representative. According to Emerson, he stands among partial men for the complete man. The partial man reverses men of genius because they are more himself than he is. Representative man. This series was published in 1850. This carries his earlier ideas further to illustrate Emerson's concept of greatness. Through a study of six men, these six great men are Plato, the philosopher, Swedenborg, the mystic, Montaigne, the skeptic, Shakespeare, the poet, Napoleon, the man of the world, and Goethe, the writer. In Emerson's opinion, the greatest man of all, except Christ, was Plato, because he has both philosopher and poet. Other prose works. Emerson's other prose works included English Tracts 1856, The Conduct of Life 1860, Society and Solitude 1870, and posthumously published Letters to Carlyle 1883 and Lectures and Biographical Sketches 1884. Poetry. The first volume of Emerson's poetry was published under the title Poem in 1847. His second volume of poetry under the title May Day and Other Pieces appeared in 1876. Commenting on Emerson as a poet, Santayana says that Emerson was a man whose religion was all poetry, a poet whose only pleasure was thought. His inmost impersonal spirit ranged abroad over the field of history and nature, gathering that idea it might and singing its title, snatch of inspired songs. Thanks.